Let's all stand together. You guys ready to worship the Lord this Sunday morning?
Amen. You may be seated, please. Good morning. It's great to see everyone here today to worship the Lord and pray that God will open up the floodgates of heaven, that He'll reveal Himself to us in a very special way, that today will not just be another Sunday that we come to church, but that the Holy Spirit will reveal Himself, that our lives will be changed and transformed by the power of Christ. Well, today's a little bit different for those who are our guests. First, let me say we welcome you and thank you that you're here. And we would like for you to take the Connect card that's in the seat in front of you, if you'll fill that out, and place that in the offering plate later in the service. But also, all of us can use that same card to write down a prayer request. We have men praying through the service. We'll collect those in just a moment, get those to them, and then I'll pray over those cards tomorrow morning. But it's a different Sunday because we had Judgment House this week, phenomenal week, which I'll say more in just a few minutes. But things are just different today. Our life group classes, some of you may normally go to a life group class right now. You skip the first hour of worship, shame on you, but that's okay. But you're here this morning in our worship service, maybe a little different. Also, we've kind of pared down what we have on stage just to make this, I guess, a more intimate Sunday as we worship the Lord. And so it's going to be a special day. And again, I'll share more about what we experienced this week as we had Judgment House. So for those now, for all of us, let's do that. Let's stand and let's greet those who are near us, especially our guests.
Good morning, I'm Wendy Durham. Here's what's going on around Linwood. Join us for Trunk or Treat at Linwood tomorrow night on October 31st from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. There will be fun, food, and fellowship in a family environment. Also, if you're planning to host a trunk, please make sure to contact Christy Bray so a spot will be reserved for you. To contact Christy or if you have any questions, please call our church office at 573-334-4600. We hope to see you there. Ladies, please join us on Friday evening, November 11th at 6 p.m. for our holiday women's event. You will have the opportunity to browse idea and resource tables for the holidays as women in our church share displays and demonstrations. Then we will hear from speaker Kim Jaggers as she shares her powerful testimony of hope. For more information and to register, visit linwoodbc.org/women. Linwood Baptist Church presents Christmas Through the Ages on December 11th, and we are asking you to join in on the celebration. If you have any family Christmas photos from the early 2000s, the 90s, 80s, 70s, or even earlier, and you would like them featured during a portion of the evening, please email those to Susan Clark by November 23rd. Photos of Linwood during Christmas from years past would be excellent. Not all the photos submitted will be included, but we want to encourage you to help make this evening a very special one. Again, please submit your photos either by email or in person to Susan Clark in the church office. This evening, in lieu of our usual evening service, we will be having a time of prayer and praise to celebrate a successful week of Judgment House. Feel free to join us here in the Worship Center at 5:30. Also, today is the deadline to register for the Forerunner trip to Grand Rivers, Kentucky. See the bulletin for details. As always, for more information on these announcements and much more, log on to linwoodbc.org. And if you're a guest with us this morning, please remember to stop by the guest services desk out in the foyer for your free gift. And welcome to Linwood.
Let's all stand together. Come on. We're going to do this song. It's about saying yes to God and maybe no to ourselves this morning, getting out of our comfort zone. And some of us, that's like clapping our hands. This little tambourine here, that's when you clap your hands. When I hit it, that's your signal, okay? One, two, three, hey! There you go. Nice.
Sing with us. With his heart open wide, from the depths, from the heights, I will bring a sacrifice. With these hands lifted high, hear my song, hear my cry, I will bring a sacrifice. I will bring a sacrifice.
Come on, let's hear it.
Take my life and let it shine. It will be my joy to say, Your will, Your way.
Let's try it your way.
It will be my joy to say, Your will, Your way. It will be my joy to say, Your will, Your way. It will be my joy to say, Your will, Your way. Always.
Lord of all. trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne.
Let's lift it up.
In Christ alone. There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever like a flood comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus, Jesus.
Sing with me, there's a place.
There's a place where sin and shame has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in of you, I'm in of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I hold to you, I hold to you. Here my hope is found, here on holy ground, here I bow down, here I bow down, here arms open wide, here you save my life, here I bow down, here I bow. Thank you.
sing at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe to you. I owe to you. Yes, I owe to you. I owe to you, Jesus.
Father, we do owe all to you because of what you've done for us through Jesus Christ. God, it's just so amazing the grace that you have given us, that which we didn't deserve. And Father, I pray that will motivate us to love you and serve you all the more. And I pray, God, that you'll help me now as I share your truth. Thank you that you've made it clear to us what the message is, what the real story of the Bible is, and what we need to do. And Lord, I pray that you'll just help me now as I communicate that. As the psalmist prayed many years ago, Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart will be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If someone were to ask you, what is the gospel? I hear you talk about that. I've read about it. Somebody tried to talk to me about the gospel. What is the gospel? Well, we understand that the word literally means good news. It means that God has revealed his story in the Bible, and it affects us. And so, obviously, the Bible tells us that we need to share. Jesus' command is to make disciples, and the first step of that is sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. But what do we say exactly? And that's why we've been doing this series of messages about sharing the gospel. It's why it's called Share. And knowing exactly what it means, because there are those who have altered the gospel, they've changed the gospel, they've watered down the gospel, diluted it to where it doesn't mean what God presented in his word. And so really we need to come back to the basics and get on the same page in order to share the gospel. I mean, isn't it true that if you go to a doctor and he diagnoses you, and doctor, what do I need to do? You want him to tell you the right thing. And we've all been diagnosed by God's word. But the same word tells us the cure. And it's the right cure. And he doesn't say it's this for a season of time, and then it's this for a season of time. It's this based on a culture. It's this based on where you live. Or all that. This is what it is. I mean, if you got cancer, this is the cure. And if you are wanting to know God and have a relationship with him, and the diagnosis is not good for you, well, which we'll see in a minute, well, I want somebody to give me the right news, the good news, okay, how that can be resolved. And so we've taken time to study it. Romans 1 through 4, Paul goes into great detail about the gospel, and through those chapters, he gives us four questions. Let's go to the anchor verse, the theme verse, Romans 1. Verse 16 and verse 17. Paul writes, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is God's power for salvation. To everyone who believes, first to the Jew and also to the Greek, for in it, that is the gospel, God's righteousness is revealed from faith to faith, just as it is written, the righteous or the just will live by faith." Now I want you to remember that last phrase there, the righteous will live by faith. Well, God knows I'm not righteous. How in the world am I going to be able to live? How am I going to be able to experience the good news, the gospel, if I'm not righteous. So I want you to remember that phrase, the righteous will live by faith, and how God helps us with that. Now, from these four questions in Romans 1 through 4, the first one is, who made me and to whom am I accountable? In other words, how did I get here and to whom am I accountable? That I'm going to have to answer for my life. The second question that Paul raises in Romans 1 through 4 is, am I in trouble? I mean, is there a problem? And what about that problem? What is the problem? Third, how can I be saved from that problem, from the result of that problem? And fourth, the question is, how can I, right here, right now, myself, be included in how God saved me from that problem? Now, from those four questions that Paul addresses in Romans 1 through 4, there are four key words that we've learned that help us as we share the gospel. It's the flow of the message. It's the story. God, man, Christ, response. Say it with me. God, man, Christ, response. I'll add another one today. God, man, Christ, response. God, meaning that God is the creator and God is holy and righteous. God created me, and therefore he has a right to tell me how to live. And based on how I live, I'm going to give an answer to him for the decisions I've made, the words that I've said, the thoughts of my own heart, the actions of my life. I'm going to be accountable to him, just as Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden. When God created them, it meant that their life had meaning, purpose, and value, just like yours does. Your life has meaning, purpose, and value. You're not here by accident. You're not here by random chance. And so that's good news. That's a great thing. But the same Bible says, again, that God is holy and righteous, and I'm going to give an account to him for what I've said and done. Now, in the Garden of Eden, he created them, and he said, your life has meaning, purpose, and value. You have responsibilities. I give you a certain level of authority. And there's a tree in the middle of the garden to remind you who put you here, and also that the authority that you have was given by me. Well, Adam and Eve said, we want to go our own way. So they chose not only to disobey God's command, not to eat of the fruit, but to reject him and reject his authority and rule over their lives. That's called sin. That's the story of every man. God's created us. He said, here's how you need to live. And we said, we don't want to live that way. We want to live our own way. And so man has sinned. And therefore, just as Adam and Eve had to face judgment for their sin, which meant death, both physical and spiritual, we too will face judgment on our sin, death and spiritual. We're separated from God both now and for all of eternity in a place called hell. And Jesus said it's a place where the worm never dies, the fire's never quenched. And then ultimately we're thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, which lasts how long? Forever. All right? Forever. The same words that are used of the eternality of heaven, forever, everlasting, etc., the exact same words are used concerning the eternality of hell. It's not temporary. It's not going to end at some point. It's forever. All right? That's bad news. That's bad news. But God solved that problem in the person of Jesus Christ. And there are several things about Jesus that people need to understand. That he's fully God and fully man. Being fully God, he's the perfect sacrifice, the sinless Son of God who is able to be the sacrifice to satisfy God's wrath against sin. But also, he is my substitute. He took my place. Therefore, I don't have to die for my sin. Somebody else did. That's Jesus. Okay, I'll get into that a little bit deeper in a minute. All right, so that's who Jesus is. He is also, as God promised, a kingdom would come. And there was going to be a messianic king who would reign on the throne of David. And he told David, God told David, that your son is going to reign on your throne forever. All right? So that's great news that was going to happen, this kingdom and this messianic king. But that king is also a suffering king. And he died on the cross to take care of our sin problem. He was an innocent man who died for us. And he shed his blood so that our sin could be forgiven. But he's also a risen king. And he lives today and wants to live in our hearts. Therefore, the next word is the word response. Man has to respond. And let's see what the Bible says about response. Notice these words in Mark 1:15. The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. Notice the command. Two things a person has to do in response to this good news, this message, is to repent and believe. That's what God requires of every single person. Now, that's seen in the New Testament and other places. Let me give you one, Acts 20:21. Here we have Paul says, I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus. So a Christian is one who turns away from his sin and trusts in Jesus Christ alone for his salvation, to be saved from sin and the coming judgment. Now, that raises a couple of questions. Number one, what is faith? When we say a person has faith, what does that mean? Well, it can mean a lot of different things. Let me give you a few as it relates to this context. Faith is not temporary faith. It's not temporary salvation. That means that I have an understanding of God. I might even say I believe in God. But the only time I acknowledge God is when I'm in trouble, when I'm in a crisis. And then all of a sudden I'm calling on God to help me. I've been living my life, but now I'm in trouble and I need God to help me. I might even start going to church for a season of time or whatever else, but I need God's help. But when things are going better, then no God. I have no regard for God. I don't live for God. I don't think about God. I'm not talking about God. I just go on my way until the next crisis. And then all of a sudden, well, I need to take care of, you know, whatever it is, so I'm going to call on God to help me. That's not saving faith, temporary faith. If I come to church every Sunday and I come in here and I do the things that you're supposed to do in here, but I go outside and the rest of the week I'm not living for God, that's not saving faith. That's temporary faith. It's a Sunday faith. And why is it a Sunday faith? Well, it's the cultural norm to go to church in Cape Girardeau, Missouri. Now, that's not true of everybody. Two-thirds don't go. But we have about a third, and that's a lot, who do go. And I know that and I have some level of respect for God, but that's temporary faith. It's not saving faith. You have New Agers who believe in stones and crystals. You have others, believe it or not, who believe in fairies. You even have people who say they believe. They're a person of faith. So what does it mean that we believe? Because saving faith is not just believing. All right, children believe in Santa Claus and the Easter Bunny. As I said, New Agers believe in stones and crystals. Even others believe in fairies. Even Christians believe in Jesus. It's no different. They believe in Jesus. You ever heard it described? That person, the media will say that's a person of faith. Well, they could be a genuine person of faith, but oftentimes it means that they have some level of respect for God, but you don't know if that belief is saving faith, what they're believing in. So we have to be careful when we use these words. It's more than just believing. What is faith? And when we use it in the word believe, it's believing, it's trusting in Jesus Christ. It is reliance in Jesus Christ and what he did on the cross for our sin. But what do we exactly believe we want Jesus to do? When we say, I'm trusting in Jesus, what are you trusting in him to do for you? Well, the greatest need of every human being is to stand before a holy God and be declared righteous. Now, when it's all said and done, that's your greatest need. Is that I'm going to stand before a holy God and I want him to say, you're okay. You're coming in. You want him to declare you righteous. Now, a big word for that, a theological word, is justification, being justified. And justification is nothing more than God declaring you righteous, that you have been made right. That's what the word righteous means. You've been made right with God. And that declaration of being right with God means that you've been justified. And every human being on the planet wants to know that when I stand before a holy God, that's what he's going to say. But guess what? He ain't going to say that when he sees us. Now, how do I render a righteous verdict? Well, I can't look within myself because I have a sin problem. And it's not that I've committed sins. I have a sin problem. There's a sin nature there. And it doesn't matter how many good things that I do, it ain't going to solve that problem of sin. And so what has happened is that we need somebody else who has a perfect, unblemished record, who is totally righteous, to be our substitute, to stand in our place. And for that person who places their faith in Jesus Christ alone for their salvation, when we stand before a holy God and He looks at us, He doesn't see our unrighteousness, He sees the righteousness of Christ. Now that's what it means to trust. I'm trusting in that moment that when I stand before God, Jesus is going to say, He's one of mine. Because Satan's the great accuser. Oh, how can you accept this guy? All these sins that he's committed in his life, and that's where Jesus is going to step forward and say, He accepted my righteousness, not his own. He confessed his unrighteousness, and he trusted in my righteousness, and therefore, I'm going to be declared innocent, not guilty. I'm going to be declared righteous in him. That's where the great exchange takes place. Listen, think about it. Our sin is imputed onto Jesus Christ. It's credited to Jesus Christ, and his righteousness is imputed to us, is exchanged to us. And so both of those things happen at the moment of salvation, and when we're declared righteous, God looks at us and sees the righteousness of Christ. So faith is trusting in the person and work of Jesus Christ. Because of that, salvation comes only through Christ and nothing else. There's no other person who can take care of your sin problem. Other religions talk about developing a moral character. And they talk about doing enough good things that your life is going to be balanced on the scales. And hopefully there are enough good things that outweigh the bad things. First of all, when the Bible says these things were written that you may know you have eternal life, 1 John 5:13, you can't know you have eternal life if that's what it's based on. How do I know that I've done enough? What's the threshold between heaven and hell? I never know. D. James Kennedy has a great illustration. If you make a three-egg omelet and one of the eggs is rotten, what's wrong with the whole omelet? It's rotten. You're not going to eat it, right? It corrupts the whole thing. If you were to do a million good acts and one bad act, one sinful act, that's enough to separate you from a holy God. And the Bible says all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Even if, see, you got a sin problem. It's not sin's problem. We have this sin nature problem, and only Christ can take care of that problem. So salvation is given to us as a gift of grace. I don't deserve that. I can't contribute anything whatsoever, not my righteousness. There's no payment I can make. There are no good works that will balance the account. Here's how we see it in Galatians 2:16. Paul says, "Yet we know that no one is justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. And we have believed in Christ Jesus, so that we might be justified, declared righteous, by faith in Christ, and not by the works of the law. Because by the works of the law, no human being will be justified." In other words, he's saying, there's nothing you can do. If all you do, the Old Testament law, the Mosaic law, if you obey it, all that it's going to do, as Paul says, is show your sin. It's going to make you realize, I can't live up to that. And there's no good thing I can do. So it's the substitute of Christ for us. That's what it means to trust in Jesus Christ. I'm trusting Him to declare me righteous because of His righteousness and not because of me. All right, let me illustrate it this way. In Judgment House, they go through the rooms and then they come to my room. And that's where we help them in their response. And so I talk about this idea of faith. And last night was the first night I used this. I only used it in two of the groups before I left. And the Lord just brought it to me. I've said it before, but not in that context. And when I talked about trusting in Jesus Christ alone, that means He becomes my substitute because I can't trust in myself. It would be like the warden of a prison coming to me and saying, "Anderson, this guy right here, he's on death row," and I'm looking at him. And he says, "This man has murdered an entire family, and he's going to the electric chair within the hour." But instead of him paying for his crime against society, we want your son. Now, I know my son's not perfect, but we want your son, or even more challenging perhaps in some ways, my grandson, six-year-old Liam, who's here today. We want him to get in that chair and take his place and die for his sin. You know what I'd say? You're crazy. There's no way I would do that. No person in their right mind would let that. That's cruelty to do that. But you know what? As I told him in that room, that's exactly what God did for you. Instead of you dying for your crime against him, he let his son get in that chair, get on the cross for your sin. Now, folks, that ought to do something to you if you're saved. That ought to remind you how great the grace and mercy of God is, that I don't deserve that, but he did that for me, and he did it for you. And if you're not saved here today, I pray that God's Spirit will help you realize God's great love for you. That's what Jesus did for you as God put his own son on the cross. A lot to say about that, but that's what we mean by faith. Now, notice what Jesus said in Mark 1:15. Repent and believe in the gospel. If faith is trusting in Jesus Christ alone for salvation, the other side of that same coin is repentance. Now, this is a serious word with Jesus and the gospel writers, that it's just not faith. The command is to repent as well, which is what? It's turning from your sin. It's changing directions and turning to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Peter said it like this in Acts 3:19. Therefore, repent and turn back that your sins may be wiped out. You want your sins wiped out? You have to repent. Paul said in Acts 26, they should repent and turn to God. So, listen, repentance is not optional. Now, this is critical to understand, especially as you're sharing the gospel with somebody. It's not just believing a set of facts about Jesus and saying, hey, I don't want to face God's wrath. I don't want that. But it means they have to understand, they have to repent. They have to change directions. For somebody to say, I've accepted Jesus as Savior, but I don't know if I'm ready to accept him as Lord. You know, there's a Greek word for that in the Greek New Testament. You know what that word is? Baloney. That's what the word is. That's not in the Bible. That's nonsense to say that I can confess that Jesus is my Savior. I believe he died on the cross for my sin, but then to live my own life and have total disregard for the effect of that transaction, whereby there's no change, then it means I'm not saved. I don't understand it. And I have to believe and I have to change my direction. What did Jesus himself say in Luke 13? Unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. When the apostles heard Peter's story about Cornelius responding to the gospel, this Gentile convert, the apostles said, so God has granted repentance resulting in life even to the Gentiles. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 7:10, talking about repentance, that it is a repentance that leads to salvation. Now, listen, the point is Jesus is not going to be in competition with anybody. What you said when you accept Christ as your Lord and Savior, I'm no longer going Satan's way and living in Satan's kingdom. I'm going God's way and living in God's kingdom. And Jesus isn't going to be in competition with the enemy while you're living in his kingdom. You can't have two lords, two masters. You're going to hate the one and love the other. And so he says there's only one and we have to repent. So repentance does not mean that a Christian will never sin. Don't misunderstand me. There's no such thing as sinless perfection. We're all human and we're still going to sin even as Christians. But repentance is an attitude of the heart. It's an attitude towards sin. It means that I don't want to do that. And there are going to be times I am going to do that, but I'm going to be deeply convicted. And that I'm going to do something about that, in that I'm going to find help. I'm going to find the Word of God or others who will help me overcome the temptations and the sins that I'm facing. So the question is, do we hate sin and war against it, or do we pursue it and defend it? Oh, what I'm doing is okay. God understands. No, he doesn't understand. It's sin. It's clearly what he has said in his word. He doesn't negotiate. We can't manage that sin and think that I'm okay if I'm not willing to repent of my sin. Now, when a person genuinely repents of his sin and turns to Christ and believes in Christ, then he's going to experience a new life. He has a new spiritual life. Here's how Paul would say it in Ephesians 2, verse 1. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you, notice, previously walked, according to this worldly age, according to the ruler of the atmospheric domain, the spirit now working in the disobedient. We too all, notice, previously lived among them in our fleshly desires, carrying out the inclinations of our flesh and thoughts, and by nature we were children under wrath, as the others were also. But God, circle those two words, amen. But God, who is abundant in mercy, because of his great love that he had for us, made us alive with the Messiah, even though we were dead in trespasses. By grace you have been saved. So when we repent and believe, our life changes. We begin to bear fruit. That's the character of Christ, Galatians 2:20. Love, joy, peace, gentleness, meekness, kindness, etc. That's the fruit of the Spirit. That's the character of Christ. Now let me explain this. It means that I am going this way, and I turn, I change directions, I'm going God's way. And so I have trusted Jesus Christ because I need to change. And if I changed, I know Jesus. No Jesus, no change. No change, no Jesus. Because listen, if a person has truly been saved, he has faith in Christ, and he has repented of his sin, everyone will know that. They'll look at that person, they'll look at you, and they will say, they're different. They're not like the world. They are like Jesus Christ. They may not know who it is, but they're going to see they've changed. That's going to whet their appetite for the good news of Jesus Christ to share. That's our greatest witness. That's our greatest testimony of the change that has happened. I'm not perfect. I'm going to sin. I sin every day. But I don't want to do that. And it tears me up when I do that. And I'm confessing my sin to God. And I stay awake at night because of it. And I can't believe that God would love me because of it. But that's my desire. And so I want to do all the more to follow him and to serve him, to glorify him with my life. And really, when I'm saved, my life is a P.S. It's a postscript saying thank you to God for all that you've done for me. So our response is faith in Christ, trusting in him alone for our salvation, and repenting, turning from our sin. Now, there's one more point that I got to emphasize real quick. Now, we have to help them understand the kingdom. That's the last word. God, man, Christ, response, kingdom. What does it mean to live in the kingdom of God? This king has come. He's a suffering king. He's a risen king. But it means that he's a reigning king. The Christian life is not just about avoiding God's wrath. None of us want that. I said a couple times in judgment room, anybody here want to go to hell? No. Nobody would. They all want to go to heaven because we don't want to face God's wrath. But see, once we are made right with God so we don't face God's wrath, now, how do I live in the kingdom? What's the kingdom life all about? Well, we find Colossians 1:13, he has rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of the Son he loves. First of all, the kingdom of God is God's redemptive reign. It's his redemptive rule, reign, and authority over those who have been redeemed, those who have been bought by the blood of Christ to live in the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God is best understood as more of a kingship than a kingdom. It's not a place where we go live. You know, the Zionist movement was an effort to have the Jews find a place to live, have their own kingdom, their own nation. We call it today what? Israel. That's where they live. Well, we don't have an earthly kingdom. We don't have a place that we go to. It is a spiritual kingdom, and we're living under a king. It's the sovereign reign of God in our hearts. That's the kingdom that we live in, that he has for us. But notice the kingdom is also a kingdom come. It's already here. Matthew 3:2, notice it says, repent, because the kingdom of God has come near. Not only did it come near, but it was in Christ. Great verse, Matthew 12:28. Jesus said, if I drive out demons by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come to you. Now, what does that mean? What is he saying? Jesus' incarnation was not just about the Creator God showing up so that you would understand who he was in the life of Christ. It was the launching of a counteroffensive against Satan, sin, and death. That's what it was. He came here to go to battle, and it led to the cross and the resurrection. That was his mission. And so it's this great counteroffensive against the enemy's kingdom. And we find that Satan began to realize that he was in big trouble when the Spirit of God led Jesus into the wilderness, and he was tested 3 times by the devil. And Jesus, how did he respond? It is written, it is written, it is written. He quoted the Word of God. He knew that his authority was based on the Word of God. And he overcame the enemy, and Satan knew, uh-oh, something's up. Then, not only that, when Jesus stared into a tomb and he cried out, Lazarus, come forth, death realized something was up when it began to lose its grip on death. It began to happen. Something's different now. It's no longer like it used to be. Death realized there's a change that's come. Then sin itself was defeated when Jesus cried on the cross, it is finished. And most of all, Satan, sin, and death knew it was over when Jesus was raised from the dead. And how we praise him for that. But they all got the message that now it is different. A kingdom has come. A kingdom is here. Notice also, it's a kingdom not yet come. We talk about a future kingdom. It's not yet come. It's not complete and won't be until the second coming of Jesus Christ. Jesus spoke of a future day when that day would come. The kingdom would be fully realized in Matthew 13. He said in Matthew 26, but I tell you, from this moment, the Lord's Supper, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it in a new way in my Father's kingdom with you. It's a different place. Then Paul talks about this kingdom that is to come in 1 Corinthians 15. In Ephesians 1, he says, in him, that is Christ, you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in him, when you believed, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. He is the down payment of our inheritance. Something else is going to happen. For the redemption of the possession to the praise of his glory. So the second coming of Christ comes, then we have the millennial reign of Christ, the 1,000-year reign of Christ. At the end of those 1,000 years, then there's going to be what we know as the final kingdom, the final kingdom. Here's how it's described in Revelation 21. Then I saw, John writes, a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea existed no longer. I saw also the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. So it's a kingdom that has not yet come, which gives us great hope. Now notice, this kingdom means that I have to live for the king. I have to live the life of the kingdom. Romans chapter 6, notice what Paul says in verse 4. Therefore we were buried with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead, by the glory of the Father, so we too may walk in a new way of life. For if we have been joined with him in the likeness of his death, we will certainly also be in the likeness of his resurrection. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, in order that sin's dominion over the body may be abolished, so that we may no longer be enslaved to sin, since a person who has died is freed from sin's claims. Now if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him, because we know that Christ, having been raised from the dead, no longer dies. Death no longer rules over him. For in that he died to sin once for all, but in that he lives to God. So you too consider yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, so that you obey its desires. And do not offer your parts, any parts of it, to sin as weapons for unrighteousness. But as those who are alive from the dead, offer yourselves to God and all the parts of yourselves to God as weapons for righteousness. Let me stop there. So notice we have this idea that now I'm living in this kingdom. I live this new life. I'm living it for the glory of God and not for the sinful desires of my flesh. Now, Paul also talks about living for the king in Ephesians 3. Let me give you two verses there. Verse 10. He's talking about the gospel itself, and he says this. Excuse me. Here we go. This is so that God's multifaceted wisdom may now be made known through the church to the rulers and authorities in the heavens. This is in accordance to the purpose of the ages which he made in the Messiah, Jesus our Lord. What he's saying is that we now are able to experience the gospel of Jesus Christ through the church. That's the arena that God has made known his wisdom and the glory of the gospel. Therefore, we have a kingdom, but the church is the embassy. The church is a local manifestation. The kingdom of God is not the church whatsoever, but it is the church that is used to manifest the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, let me stop there for just a moment, and I want to answer this question. Why is this important? Why is it important to understand of how to live and why we should live in the kingdom of God? And how that affects us today, right now, in this room, with what we're going through in life. I don't often read this type of material at this setting, but I can't say it any better than Paul Tripp said it. And listen to what he said. There are so many reasons to be discouraged in this fallen world. It's a wonder that anyone is happy. It's discouraging to watch your marriage turn cold and distant. It's disheartening to be betrayed by a dear friend. It's disappointing to lose the job you worked at with such commitment. It's depressing to face a sickness that you're not sure you'll ever lick. It's hard to face the rebellion and rejection of one of your children. It's discouraging to hear so often about corruption in politics and government. Hello. It's disheartening to have to be concerned about crime and injustice. It's tough to deal with the weaknesses of old age. It's hard to be mocked and rejected for your faith. It's sad to see your church become more a place of controversy than gospel healing. It can seem as if everything in your life is in the process of decaying or in danger of going bad. People die, dreams die, flowers die, and marriages, churches, jobs, and friendships go bad. If you look around, this old world that God created isn't doing very well. In many ways, it's a hard, discouraging place to live. The downward spiral of the fallen world can get to you. It seems that everything is impermanent or in the process of falling apart. But that's not all that's discouraging. It often seems as if you're powerless to make much of a change. You do everything you can to restore your marriage, but it just seems stuck. You know you don't have the power to change other people, and you have limited power to change situations. It so often seems that you're a witness to or affected by things you have little ability to alter. So where is encouragement to be found? It's found in grace, as depicted by these beautiful words of our Lord. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. With these words, everything changes. These words tell you that it's not you against a world gone bad. Yes, you are a citizen of this world and you are touched by its brokenness. But as you are, you must remind yourself that you are the citizen of another kingdom. Your king rules over everything that would discourage and disappoint you, and he rules for your good and his glory. What is out of your control is under his rule. What you don't understand is under his careful administration. But there is more. While everything around you seems impermanent, this kingdom will have no end. Long after the kingdom of this world has been destroyed, you will reign with your king in his kingdom forever and ever and ever. And all of God's people said, amen. Now that's what it's about. That's why we need to share the gospel. It's to help people be rescued out of a kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God. into the kingdom of the Son he loves. And that's what they're facing. That's what some of you are facing right now. And that's why many Christians live defeated lives, because they're not learning how to live the kingdom life. Who is your real king? And who's in control of all this madness? And what's the future of the life that I have and all the failures and disappointments and discouragements of my life? Man, I'm telling you, it's great hope. It's good news to tell people about there's a different kingdom. And you can be a part of that kingdom, which leads me to my last point, is that it calls for a response to the king. The king says, I have a kingdom for you. Now I want you to live in my kingdom. Now in Judgment House, they go through the scenes and they come into the last room. The room where I am is the decision room. And here's what I say. Because see, here's the question. What are you going to do with Jesus? And this is my first sentence out of my mouth. In this room, I'm going to help you think about and respond to the last question you just heard. That's the last thing that God will say to them. And I'm going to help you respond to that question. And then I just share what I've been sharing with you. I sum it up very quickly. And I said, what I'm going to ask you to do is I'm going to ask you to have faith in Jesus Christ alone for your salvation. And I'm going to ask you to repent. I'm going to ask you to change directions, to turn. And I'll tell them, you're going down your way, your road, your life. And I'm going to ask you to turn, to change directions. And I'm going to ask you to go God's way. To leave that kingdom of darkness and be rescued by turning and being taken to a new kingdom. The kingdom of life. The kingdom of light. The kingdom of God. And this point of changing directions can happen right now in this room. And friends, the same thing can happen right now in this big room. There might be somebody here right now who needs to do that very thing. You need to make a commitment to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You have to believe in Him. You got to trust that He's going to stand before a holy God and declare you righteous because of His work on the cross. And secondly, you have to be willing to repent. You're at a point in life, you've tried it your way, it's not going to solve your problem. It's not helping you now. And now you have the opportunity to turn to Christ and begin to follow Him. So I'm going to do in here what I've done every night this week. I want you to bow your head and I want you to close your eyes. There might be somebody here today who would say, Pastor, I need to do this very thing. I need to place my trust in Christ and Him alone for my salvation. And I need to turn from my sin and turn to Christ. I'm willing to repent, to change directions. I can't pray you into heaven, but I can help you verbalize the desire of your heart to follow Jesus Christ. This is not just praying a prayer. Nobody in the Bible prayed a prayer and was saved. What they did is they trusted in Christ and they repented of their sin. They changed directions. And the first step of that is calling on the name of the Lord, and that's what we're going to do right now. So while I pray this prayer out loud, I'm going to ask you to pray it quietly in your heart if you feel like this is what you need to do. And let me tell you how you'll know that. If there's a tug in your heart, a pull, you know there's something drawing you, that's God's Spirit. If there's something that's saying to you, you don't need to do that, that's the devil saying that. And you're in this great battle, and now you're going to have to choose. What are you going to do with Jesus Christ? Either he is who he said he is, he's the biggest liar that ever lived, or he is the sinless Son of God. So you pray this prayer quietly in your heart as I pray it out loud. Dear God, thank you for loving me. I know that I'm a sinner, but I believe Jesus died on the cross for my sin. I also believe He rose again on the third day. Right now, I ask Jesus Christ to come into my heart, to forgive me of my sin, to turn from my way and turn to God's way, and receive your gift of eternal life in heaven. Thank you, Jesus, for coming into my heart. Help me each day to live for you. With your head still bowed and eyes closed, there, I would ask them to raise their hand and somebody would help them with this commitment. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. I'm going to ask you to do something more courageous. I'm going to ask you to get up and I'm going to ask you to walk down this aisle in just a moment and openly confess your faith in Jesus Christ. What's our theme verse? I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I want everyone to know that I'm changing directions. And so in just a moment, we're going to sing this song of worship as we respond to what God is saying in our hearts. The second thing I would say to them is there might be somebody here who's already made this commitment or something like it. But if you were honest, you would say, Pastor, I'm not where I should be spiritually, and I want to get back on the right path. And there's somebody that will help you do that right now. In fact, just a moment, when you come, somebody will help you. Or I will say to them, maybe you're okay with God, but man, you're going through a tough time, and you just need somebody to pray for you. Then I'm going to ask you to come in just a moment, and we have somebody who will pray for you. Now, in this setting, there might be somebody that God is leading you to become part of our church family. And we would love to have you become part of a church that is gospel-centered, not a perfect church. But we believe in the power of the gospel, that it leads to salvation, and that we help people understand what it means to live in the kingdom of God. And so we would love for you to be a part of that, and what God's doing here and all around the world. And so if God is speaking to your heart about that, in just a moment, you come when we sing. Father, thank you for these who have made commitments to you. I pray that you'll help them now as they take these steps of faith and obedience. And Lord, we just ask that your Holy Spirit will have its way in our hearts right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you quietly stand while we sing this next song? As God speaks to your heart, you come.
There is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son, precious Lamb of God, Messiah.
own Son, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One.
Would you bow your head and close your eyes for just a moment? There's still time for you to come. Or maybe you just need to talk to the Lord, share your heart with Him, and let Him minister His grace and His love to you right now. Amen. You may be seated, please. We continue our worship as we give to the Lord our tithes and our offerings. For those who are members of our church, thank you for your faithfulness in giving to the Lord. Men, if you'll go ahead and make your way. And for those who are guests, if you filled out a guest card earlier, then you'll want to place that in the offering plate as your gift to us this morning. Remember that the time of response is not over. And if you need to talk to somebody privately after the service, then please find one of us, maybe somebody sitting near you. They'll be able to get you to the right person so that we can help you understand what God is saying to your heart this morning. So let's prepare our hearts as we give to the Lord. Jeff, you come and lead us in prayer as we give.
Lord, we just thank you for this beautiful day, Lord, and we just thank you for the gospel message, Lord. We just thank you for sending your Son to die on the cross for our sins, Lord. We thank you for all the decisions that were made this week during Judgment House, Lord, and we just pray for all those people that they'll get the discipleship that they need. We just thank you for this offering we're about to receive. Bless the gift and the giver, Lord. In your name I pray. Amen.
Keep your lamp
trimmed and burning.
Keep your lamp
trimmed and burning.
Keep your lamp
trimmed and burning.
See what the Lord has done. Father, don't
get worried.
Father, don't
get worried.
Father, don't
get worried.
For the work is almost done. Brother, don't
get worried.
Brother, don't
get worried.
For the work is almost done. Heaven's journey
on before us.
Heaven's journey.
Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated, please. We could sum up that entire song with one word: share. Let your light shine. Keep that wick trimmed and burning. Amen. And so, Gabe, thank you for leading us in worship this morning. Let me mention a few things. Tonight we will have our Judgment House celebration. It's going to be a different service. It's going to be a very uplifting, glorifying service. And you need to understand, every night, almost every group that came through, commitments were made. Over 1,000 people came through. 83 people gave their heart to Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Amen. Eighty-nine people made a recommitment. They knew the Lord, but they wanted to get back on the right path, praise God. And then another 97 who said, I need prayer individually for a need in my life. So God moved in a great way. Let's give Him the praise for all those commitments. Very important, very significant. Amen. Now tonight you're going to hear a lot more. It's going to be a great time together, and we'll celebrate. So be sure and be here, okay? Then next Sunday, Saturday night into Sunday morning, time change, all right? So I'm sure I'll see some of you early. Can't wait to get in the doors, right? And so we want you to be here and worship, but be pay attention to the time change. And we have a guest with us today, Josh McClain. Josh, raise your hand right over here. Josh, let's welcome Josh this morning, all right? Josh is a great kid. Josh was Will's roommate at Liberty University for a couple of years. He's still not over it. He's still recovering from that experience with Will. But he came down from St. Louis to visit with us for a few days. Josh, good to have you, brother. All right, let me mention these that have come this morning. First of all, Paul and Linda Berry, if you'll come and stand here. These two have been visiting our church for some time. Both of them know the Lord, and they want to unite with our church family, be part of the body of Christ. And so we're delighted to have you a part of what God's doing here and how you're going to contribute to what God's doing here at our church. And then Julie and Lexi Gurley, why don't y'all come and stand right here next to me? And these two also have been visiting our church. And Julie came this morning and she said that I want to rededicate my life. I've known the Lord, but I want to recommit my life and become part of this church family. Her daughter Lexi came to know Christ Wednesday night at Judgment House. She was one of those 83 who made a commitment, and she wants to follow through with baptism and to also want to be a part of our church family. And so if you rejoice in these commitments this morning, would you join me by saying amen? Amen. Before we go, you'll want to come by and introduce yourself to these who've come. But I need to ask you to pray. You need to pray for the follow-up that's going to take place with those who made commitments. If they were tied to another church, we send a letter to that pastor or youth pastor and say, here are the commitments that were made concerning your church group, and we let them follow up. We don't proselytize in that way. Secondly, there are many who are wrestling right now spiritually. They are in the battle, and they're struggling knowing what to do. They know what they should do, among many things, not just salvation. So you pray that they will listen to God's voice and respond to God's voice. And we've seen in Judgment House throughout the months after Judgment House, people who finally come to terms and they'll follow through with baptism. They will get things right in their life or whatever else. So we've got a lot of work to do ahead, and somebody may talk to you about it, okay? So be praying about that, all right? For those who are guests, if I've not met you personally, I would love to do so in the foyer after the service. And I pray for all of you that God will empower you to share the hope that we have in Jesus Christ this week. God bless you.